Welcome to GYAS. How are you? I hope you are doing well. So friends, as you know that on our channel, we cover the syllabus of UPSC Civil Services, and for that purpose, we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So currently, we have 10 series that target your prelims, in which we cover daily 10 MCQs, and a particular day is allotted to a particular topic. In a week, we approximately cover 100 to 150 questions. So And in mains oriented series, we daily give you 3 answers for answer writing practice. So what we now do in these prelim series, we daily give you, as I have told you, we pick up a topic and we discuss 10 MCQs that are of UPSC prelims level. So we discuss them and we kind of give a lecture on them. And in this way, we have allotted a particular day to a particular topic. And in this way, in a week, we approximately cover 100 to 150 questions. So in today's video, that is of economy series, that is lecture number 2, we will be covering the MCQs of economy, that is 10 MCQs of economy. So let's see what are the today's MCQs. First question is, advanced pricing agreements are related to A. settlement of sovereign tax liabilities with international banks, B. providing certainty to taxpayers in the domain of transfer pricing, C. capping inflow financial instruments from tax havens, and pricing, and in the D is pricing and investment matters in special economic zones. So here we have to choose the advanced pricing agreement is related to. So friends, out of these 4, let me tell you that the answer is B, that is providing certainty to taxpayers in the domain of transfer pricing. So basically, it is an agreement in which the countries they enter into agreement with companies that operate, that are multinationals, and that have transactions between their multiple subsidiaries. So this is a kind of a much important issue for foreign direct investment. So here is the justification. So it was basically introduced in income tax in 2012, and rollback provisions were introduced in 2014. So this scheme is basically to provide certainty to taxpayers in the domain of transfer pricing by specifying the methods of pricing and setting the prices of international transactions in advance. So here, in what is done in advance pricing agreement, the price of a particular commodity is determined in advance by following a particular method, and that method is used to determine the price of a particular good or service. That method is transparent, and the company which, for example, in India, it has to import certain good, or that good for that matter in future, then that good must be imported at that rate only, that is determined in advance. So rate will not be changed. Earlier, what the companies used to do, they used to cite high quotations while importing a particular good from their subsidiary company. For example, a particular company is, for example, operating in India, and it is subsidiary of certain MNC operating in America. So certainly, if it needs some raw material for the production of its final goods, it will need the raw material, and it will import it from its parent company, for example. So in order to avoid tax in India, so in order to show less tax, what the companies used to do, they used to show high quotations or high prices of a particular good which they are buying from their parent company. So in this way, they used to hide the profits. So ultimately, the money got transferred to the parent company without paying much tax in India. So this was the major issue. So this advanced pricing agreement was introduced in 2012 to eliminate this anomaly. And basically, this is about kind of providing certainty to taxpayers in the domain of transfer pricing. So this is about your first question, as I have explained to you in great detail. So it was used to evade the tax by showing lower profits in higher taxation sector to reduce the tax burden. So let's move on to the second question. The second question is, generally, a Ponzi scheme should fail if. So you might have heard about friends Ponzi scheme. Nowadays this scheme is in news also. For the issue of the issue in West Bengal of a kind of scam of Ponzi schemes and chit funds, in which the current raid of CBI happened on the police chief of Kolkata. So second question is, a Ponzi scheme should fail if first new investments into the scheme are stopped, second old investors are paid profits on their investment. So friends, let me tell you that the correct statement is one, because Ponzi scheme will fail if the new investments doesn't take place into a particular scheme. So why it is so? Because basically Ponzi scheme relies on the continuous flow of income. So it relies on the continuous flow of investments from new investors. So what, how these schemes give the money to their old investors? They give the money by the continuous flow of money from new investors. So the old investors are given profits by this continuous flow of money from new investors. And in case the new investors stop investing, and in case new investments stop coming, the Ponzi scheme will fail. And this is generally a fraud. Basically, these schemes are fraud schemes. So the correct answer is one, that is new investments into the scheme are stopped. So regarding the second statement, yes, friends, the old investors are paid profits on their investment, but it doesn't in its wording says that or proves that the Ponzi scheme will fail in this manner. Obviously, the profits will have to be paid, but the issue is the how it will fail in case the investments stop coming into these schemes. So the correct answer is A only, that is A, that is first one only. So this is the answer. So it is basically Ponzi schemes are investment fraud which depend upon continuous coming of new clients. So they mainly focus on energies on attracting the new clients. So this is about your Ponzi scheme. Let's move on to the third question. The third question is, the logistics performance index measures the performance of a country's logistics across which of the following components. So here we have been asked that there is a logistics performance index which measures the particular country's logistics across different components. It takes into account different components. So here we have been asked that which of the following constitute the components of this logistics performance index. First is volume and economic value of logistics clearance each year. Second, international shipments. Three, average number of corruption cases exposed by the governmental investigation in agencies. So friends, let me tell you that one and three has no link with logistic performance index. The logistic performance index is measured by different types of constituents, and one of its constituent is also the international shipment. So the only correct statement is second only. So the answer would be D, that is second only. So here is explanation about logistics performance index. It measures country across six components while judging its logistics sector. So it takes into consideration the customs, the infrastructure, the international shipment, logistics quality and competence. So it is basically released by World Bank, and it is used by the countries to identify the challenges and opportunities in trade logistics, and also it is also used by the other countries or the companies, the foreign investment companies, to judge a particular to judge the logistics sector of a particular country. So it is released by World Bank. So it provides kind of on-ground feedback on the logistic friendliness of a particular country. So let's move on to the fourth question. The fourth question is, when a country joins IMF, it is assigned an initial quota which takes into account which of the following factors. So friends, when a country joins IMF, it is allocated a particular quota. So how it is decided? So this question is about this. The first is openness of the economy, second WTO compliance, three size of GDP, fourth international reserves, five political structure. So let me tell you friends that while determining the quota, the openness of the economy is taken into consideration, because 30% weight is given to the openness of economy, and also size of GDP is considered, and 50% weight is given to the size of the GDP, and also international reserves are considered. So certainly the answer will be here, the openness of the economy, one, and then the size of the economy, and this should be 3, and international reserves 4. So the answer would be B. That is, solution is B. So it is a kind of it is determined by a formula that is taking weighted average of GDP. That is given the weightage of 50%, the openness that is given the weightage of 30%, and the economic variability that is given the weightage of 15% in international reserves. So this is basically how this quota is determined. So currently the largest member of IMF is the United States, that USA. So let's move on to the fifth question. Fifth question is, consider the following about Sagarmala Development Company. So here we have been asked to consider certain statements about Sagarmala Development Company. First, it will be under the administrative control of Ministry of Commerce and Industry. Second, the main objective of the company is to identify port-led development projects under the Sagarmala program. Third is, it would undertake the preparation of detailed master plans for coastal economic zones identified as part of the National Prospective Plan. So let me tell you, friends, that the correct statement is, correct statements are 2nd and 3. 2 and 3 only are correct, because 1st is incorrect. It is not under the administrative control of Ministry of Commerce and Industry, rather it is under the administrative control of Ministry of Shipping. So this is the answer would be C, that is 2nd and 3rd only. So this is the solution, as I have told you. So basically Sagarmala program is started by the government of India to harness the potential of India's long coastline as well as the waterways that are potentially navigable. So also to harness the potential of strategic locations that India controls on international maritime trade routes. So also this sustainable development company is under the control of Ministry of Shipping, and also it provides equity support for the project special purpose vehicles set up by port, states, central ministries and funding window, and or implement only those residual projects which cannot be funded by any other means. So also, friends, this Sagarmala program, a national prospective plan is prepared for the development of coastline and maritime sector. So this is prepared. So it has identified more than 150 projects across the areas of port modernization and new port development, port connectivity enhancement, port industrialization and coastal community development. So this is about your fifth question. So let's move on to the sixth question. Sixth question is, convertibility of rupee implies freely permitting the conversion of rupee to other currencies and vice versa. If India allows full capital account convertibility, it may result in. So friends, here we have been asked that if India allows full capital account convertibility, it will result in, first, greater volatility in the exchange rates, second, attraction of foreign direct investment in India, third, India choosing to maintain very low foreign exchange reserve. So let me tell you, friends, that the correct statements are 1 and 2 only. Third is incorrect. So if India allows foreign capital account convertibility, full capital account convertibility, then it will attract obviously FDI, and there will be greater volatility in exchange rates, because now the exchange rates will be determined by the market. So the option is A. So it is basically this free capital account convertibility means FDI and FII will be allowed to move in and out of the country without any restrictions. So obviously this will, if there are no restrictions, the FDI will be greater, FDI will be attracted, but also similarly FII will also be attracted. But let me tell you that foreign institutional investors, it is a speculative money, it is highly volatile money. It may come into a country at a particular time, and it also may move outward, and it creates volatility in exchange rates. So both 1 and 2 are correct, but let me tell you that 3rd is not correct, because this high volatility in the exchange rate pushes a country to maintain enough foreign exchange reserves, because these foreign institutional investors' money can't be invested in India. Only FDI can be invested in India. FIIs are volatile money, they're hot money. So they for that purpose forex reserves can be invested, and they for the purpose of meeting an emergency balance of payment situation, the high forex reserves have to be maintained. So certainly there is no role of maintaining low forex reserves. So third statement is incorrect. So let's move on to the seventh question. The seventh question is, two nations at purchasing power parity are likely to have. First statement, equal currency value in international market. Second, equal forex reserves. Third, equal national income when measured in a common currency. So let me tell you, friends, that purchasing power parity, if both the nations have some same purchasing power parity, then it means that both the nations have same income when measured in a common currency. So the correct answer is third only, because one and two is not correct. So the statement is statement that is correct is second. That so the answer is solution is B, that is third only. So purchasing power parity is basically to use to compare the countries, different countries, in terms of their income level. So if purchasing power parity of two countries is similar, then it means that the meaning of this is that they have equal income, and also their currencies have the equal capacity to buy a particular good. So for take the example of sandwich. So certainly sandwich is the only good made in India and USA. So it costs rupees 120 in India and rupees 2 in USA, dollar 2 in USA. So if we suppose that the current rupee dollar exchange rate is 60, then it means that $1 is equal to 60, then obviously and then the market value of sandwich of in both the nations will be same. It will be 120 in India and it will be $2 in USA. So the purchasing power parity of both the nations will be same, both the currencies will be same. So this shows that the two nations have equal income. So in this terms, so take for example the case if the sandwich in India is of rupees 50, and for take for example in that sandwich is in US is of rupee, is of $2, and $1 amounts to 60, and then $2 amounts to 120. That means in India sandwich is much cheaper to buy, because in USA the same sandwich, for buying the same sandwich a person would have to pay rupees 120 or $2. So because the exchange rate is 60, so the purchasing power parity of both the nations in that case will not be same, because the currency of the India will have higher purchasing capacity in that case. So this is about your purchasing power parity. So I have already explained to you in great detail. So let's move on to the eighth question. The eighth question is, India is world's third largest importer of crude oil after United States and China. Oil imports in India are high and have soared up in recent years, and which of the following reasons can be attributed to this? So here we have been asked that what could be the possible reasons for the high imports of oil. A. India does not have sufficient crude oil reserves. B. Oil exploration activity in India is suboptimal and remains much below potential level. Domestic crude oil production has been falling in recent years. So D, all of the above. So let me tell you, friends, that all of the above is the correct answer, because India does not have currently sufficient crude oil reserves, and also oil exploration activity is suboptimal. It is not up to that much level, and also domestic crude oil production has been falling in recent years. So D, all of the above is the correct answer. So this here, there is no explanation required in this case. So this is a very simple question. So I have told you the solution. So let's move on to the ninth question. Which of the following is vital for a country to reap its demographic dividend? So you friends, you might have heard about the term demographic dividend. So basically, term demographic dividend means that a particular country has high number of people that are in working age as compared to the number of people that are dependent. So India. So in India currently people that are in working age group are higher as compared to the dependent age groups. The dependent age groups are the children and the elderly. So India has currently this demographic dividend, but there are certain conditions in which this dividend could be harnessed. So here we have been asked that which of the following can help a particular country to reap its demographic dividend. A. Withdrawing food and energy subsidies given to poor citizens. B. Investing in universal healthcare system. C. Inviting foreign institutional investment. D. Operating as a command economy. So the answer would be in this case would be B, that is investing in universal healthcare systems. So because why, friends, this is correct? Because in this case only the demographic dividend will be harnessed. Because if a country's population, working age population, is in healthier condition, then obviously its productivity will also be higher. So in that case, that economy will be able to harness this demographic dividend. So this is the correct answer is B. So solution is B. So I have already explained to you that it occurs when the proportion of working people in the total population is high. So basically, universal health coverage helps in this helps in building this healthy workforce, and also investing in education helps a country to harness the potential of its demographic dividend. So let's move on to the 10th question. That is the last question. The last question is, disguised unemployment will result if. So here question is about disguised unemployment. So A, a firm hires too many workers to complete a one-man job. B, a large number of people in a nation are engaged in the services sector. C, the output from the industrial sector is low. D, there is high unemployment and heavy migration. So friends, here the answer would be, let me tell you that the here answer would be A, a firm hires too many workers to complete a one-man job. Friends, but what is disguised unemployment? Basically, it is type of employment in which people appear to be employed, but if they are moved out of the workforce, then of the they are moved to certain other sector, then the productivity of that particular sector in which they were earlier engaged, that will not reduce. For example, if four people are engaged in a particular economic activity, but only one person is required there, then obviously the three persons are disguisedly engaged there, so they are actually unemployed. So that type of unemployment is called disguised unemployment. So the correct answer is A. So already I have provided you the explanation. So this is all about, friends, today's video. If you liked it, if you like the questions, please share it with your friends. Please like it, and also tell me in the comment box if you have any suggestion. And lastly, friends, if you want to subscribe to the PDFs of these daily MCQ discussions, then you can do WhatsApp us at this number 8968426481. So certainly there will be certain charges that we will be charging for this purpose, because we are putting in a lot of efforts for preparing these PDFs. So in case you want to subscribe to the PDFs of these MCQs, then you can do WhatsApp us at this number, that is 8968426481. So friends, also, let me tell you that why these PDFs are important. Explanation PDFs are important because at the end of the day, you will not be able to see it 25 to 30 minute long video, and also at that time, you will not be able to revise through standard books or NCERTs for that matter, because at that time, you will have lot of topics to cover. You would have to cover multiple issues like, you know, economic survey, budget, and all those India yearbook and other things, and other portions of the syllabus also. So at that time, you must have some kind of notes in which from which you can revise quickly, and your revision can takes place in a comprehensive manner, and your revision doesn't bore you. So this PDF format is the most effective format of revision, because it helps you in revision in an interesting manner, because reading standard books two three times after two three times become monotonous. If in that case, for keeping your interest high, these MCQ pattern is very important, because in this you first read the question, and then you go for its answer, and then you go for its explanation. So in this way, your concepts are revised, and you cover all important concepts, because MCQs are designed in that way only, so that it matches the UPSC standard. So friends, this is all about today's video. If you want to subscribe to the PDFs, you can do WhatsApp us at this number, that is 8968426481. So friends, also please do not forget to subscribe to our channel, and also do not forget to press the bell icon, because then only you will get all the important notifications relating to UPSC CSC 2019 that we do on our channel. So this is all about today's video, friends. Thank you very much. Have a nice day.